So good morning to one and all. So we are discussing the sampling oscilloscope. In the last class, we are discussing about sampling storage oscilloscope, sampling oscilloscope, storage oscilloscope. Okay. So by using this storage oscilloscope, we can store the applied signal, so which is having very low frequency. The signals which are having very low frequency, and those signals will be stored by using storage target, which is present in the CRT of the storage oscilloscope. CRT of the storage oscilloscope. Okay. So by using the storage target, so we can store the applied by using the storage target, we can have to produce the signal, so for the number of hours. Okay, so whereas in the normal or other CRTs, the applied signal will be disappears within 1 second. So whereas in storage oscilloscope, we can observe the waveform for the few hours also. So because the electron guns will be produces the low velocity of the electrons. So those electrons will be passes through the positive charged particles of the storage mesh. Okay. And through this, these electrons will flow, and those will be hit by the positive material of the CRT screen. Okay, so these positive charge carriers of the storage mesh will be formed by before the flood gun electrons are passed through this. So that is done by the writing gun will produce the beam of electrons through vertical and horizontal electrons. And when those electrons will be hit by this storage surface, and that where these electrons will be hit by this storage surface, that particular area becomes as a positive charge. Okay, and remaining will be becomes as a negative. Okay, so when so like that it will be. So like that it will be the first of all, the applied signal will be first writes or creates the charge carriers on the storage mesh. Okay, so that is fixed. Okay, so after certain amount of after that, so we can apply the electrons through the flood gun, so not from the writing gun. So we will apply from the flood gun, and due to that the electrons will be passes through this charge carriers, positive charge carriers, and reaches the CRT screen. Okay, and the electrons which are not allowed to pass because pass through this storage mesh, they will be reflected, and those electrons will be collected by the collector mesh. Okay, like this we can so the electrons will be passed through this positive charge carriers will be falls on the beam, the fast material, and that that electrons will be eliminates. So how much time we can allow the flood gun is on? Okay, when the flood gun is on, the writer gun is will be off. Okay, so the writing gun will be off. So when the flood gun is how much time we can be on? So that much amount of time we can read the signal. That much amount of time the signal will present on the positive screen. Okay, so that's why we can make a storage of the applied signal. Okay, so how so suppose we have measured some voltage. So after certain amount of time we have to measure the another voltage. So then what we have to do is So we have to make this storage surface into equal charge, same charge. You can make it as same charge. Okay, so it is ready for the next signal to be analyzed, for the next signal to be applied. So before that, so we have to make this positive charging surface areas should be erased. So that will be done by making this storage mesh electrode will be applied a negative signal, and due to that this electrode entire charge area will become as a negative. Okay, so equally charge will be equally distributed. Okay, so then we can apply the next another signal, and by applying of the next signal again that particular beam of electrons will be falls on the different areas of the storage surface. Okay, and that particular area will become as positive. Okay, and the remaining area where the electrons are not hit the storage area will be as negative. Okay, so like this we can generate the or produce this signal for the number of hours. Okay. So and after this sampling and storage oscilloscopes, we have the next oscilloscope is a digital readout oscilloscope. So digital readout oscilloscope, this oscilloscope will be used to read the how much time it was happened for each sample. So for the consideration of this sample to sample, how much time it was taken. So that will be read by using some counter. So this is the blow diagram which represents the digital readout oscilloscope when measuring the voltage. So when we have to measure the voltage, so that voltage will be first applied to the vertical amplifier, same as it is that. So and for the sampling oscilloscope, how we can produce the samples. So for the sampling oscilloscope, we will produce the samples based upon the staircase signal. For depending upon the input signal and the staircase step pulses, it will be produces the samples. So whereas in this case, this digital readout oscilloscope, so we will use a signal with 0% memory and 100% memory. So in that particular period of time, how much pulses are generated? So that we will be considered in digital readout oscilloscope. So before that, we have to produce a comparator. So we can use the comparators. So for measuring of the low voltage, and that is 0% and 100% voltage. Okay, so that 100% and 0% voltage are obtained by using a potential divider here. So here we have a potential divider. So by using this potential divider, we can adjust the obtained voltage. So as a 0% and maximum it will be as a 100%. And these two voltages are applied to the, one is for the start comparator and another is for the stop comparator. So in addition to the vertical amplifier, horizontal deflection plates, horizontal deflection system, so these are additional circuitry which are used in digital readout oscilloscope. Okay, in addition to obtaining of the signal as it is, same as our sampling oscilloscope. Okay, in addition to that, we can also get the time. So measures the time count. So that count, that time will be measured by the counter. So this time is nothing but the time between sample to sample. Okay, so it will display the time for the each sample, how much time it was taken for producing of the samples. Okay, so that is displayed. The time taken for that one is displayed by using the counter. Okay, and before that, so we have to compare the so for each here we will produce the sample signals. So samples we will produce the, so the samples signals will be applied to the start comparator, and this start comparator will compare with the 0% voltage memory. Okay, so this 0% voltage memory, okay, from that we can consider the 0% voltage memory voltage is applied to the start comparator. So when these two voltages are equal, so this comparator will produce a pulse, and that is nothing but the open gate. Gate will be open. So that is clock gate will be opens. So it means this gate clock will be open. Means it is becomes as high. Okay. So in such situation, the sample signal will sense the number of clock pulses. And number of samples here it will from sense the number of samples. Okay, and those samples will be displayed in terms of the digital display. Okay, so after that, so this is the starting of the clock gate. Okay, it means opening of the clock gate. So when the sample signal is reaches the 100% of the interval, 100% of the this is the 100% of the voltage. So with that, again it will be compared. When these two will be equal, it produces a pulse that becomes as a closed gate. By that, the gate will be closes. Okay, and in between, how many samples are generated by using the sample generator, and those samples will be counted. Okay, and that number of samples will be displayed on the counter. So this is the main function of the digital diode oscilloscope. So here the input waveform is sampled, and the sampling circuit advances this sampling position in fixed increments, and that process is called as strobing. So strobing. So here in this case, the sampling position is increased by fixed increment. So the sampling position. So we can make the samplings so equal increments. Okay. So and the first of all, the input waveform is sampled, so as shown in the sampling oscilloscope. Okay, and those samples will be the sampling circuit advances the sampling position in fixed increments, and a process that is called strobing. Okay, the equivalent time between the each sample depends on the number of samples taken per centimeter and on the sweep time per centimeters. The time between each sample. So the time between each sample depends on the number of samples taken per centimeter and the sweep time of the sweep generator. That is, we can call it as sweep rate. Okay, the sweep rate for time per centimeters. For example, a sweep rate of 1 nanoseconds per centimeters, and a sampling rate of 1000 samples per centimeter, gives a time of 10 picoseconds per sample. Suppose we have a sweep rate. So sweep rate is nothing but the sweep generator produces this much of sweep rate. Okay. So assume that this is the 1 nanoseconds, and we are considering a sample rate of 100 samples per centimeter. Sample rate we are considering as a 100 samples per centimeters. Okay. So from this 1 nanosecond, 1 into 10 to the power of minus 9. Okay. Per centimeters, and the sampling rate is 100 samples per centimeters. So from that we can get the sample how much for producing of one sample, how much time it is taken is considered by the 100 picoseconds. So this is obtained by 1 nanosecond per centimeters and 100 samples per centimeters. So this is nanoseconds per 100 samples per centimeter. 100 samples. So that becomes as this 100 will goes to numerator. So that will be formed as a 10 to the power of minus 2. So here this is 10 to the power of minus 9 and this is 10 to the power of minus 2. Okay. And from this we'll get the 10 picoseconds per sample. Okay. So we'll get the 10 picoseconds per sample. So we can get this one by our own. So there is no confusion. So 1 nanoseconds per centimeter. So in the place of centimeters, we can use the 100 samples. Okay. 100 samples will produce the 10 picoseconds per sample. Okay. So to produce one sample, it will take 10 picoseconds for a 1 nanosecond centimeters of sweep rate and sampling rate of 100 samples per centimeter. So here, by using distal readout, we can measure the time taken for each sample. How much time it was taken for generation of one sample. So here we will see two intensified portions of CRT trace. So identified as 0% and 100% zone position. So each zone can be shifted to any part of the display. Here we are using a voltage divider. So that voltage divider taps between 0% and 100% of the memory. Okay, and those will be used for this starting and stop of the timer. So here we are using a clock gate. So for that, starting and stopping will be produced by the 0% and 100% memory voltage. The coincidence of any of the input waveforms with the selected percentage point is sensed by the voltage comparator. So here we are using a voltage comparator. This comparator will compare the sample signal and the selected voltage memory tapping. So here we have 0 tapping and 100% tapping. So 0% tapping and 100% tapping, these two will be compared with the sample signals. Okay, and this sample signal, when these two sample signals are compared with the 0, it will produce the start gate, start pulse. And when this stand signal will compare with the 100% voltage memory voltage, so then it produces the closed pulse. So in between, the clock gate will produces the samples, and those samples will be measured in terms of the display. So here, here we can use the Nixie display. So the number of clock pulses which corresponds to the actual sample taken are read out digitally in a Nixie display. Tube in nanoseconds, microseconds, milliseconds, and seconds. So we can measure in the samples taken time will be measured in nanoseconds, micro, milli, and seconds also. So this is the Nixie tube display. Nixie tube display. So these are the voltages they will use. So in place of using this Nixie tube, we can use also use the 7-segment display. 7-segment display. So the another one. Using digital readout CRO, we can convert the voltage to time. So we can convert the voltage to time. So this is the voltage. Okay, and in this we can have two settings. So okay, so for a given period of settings of the time period, so how much samples are collected? Okay, so that sampling rate. So this voltage will use the sampling rate. How much amount of sampling time? So we can produce the sampling time. Okay, so in that particular sampling time, how many samples are generated? So that will be counted by this counter. So that sampling time will be produced by using the this sample signal. Okay, and from this we can have 0% voltage memory and 100% voltage memory. So minimum value of the signal and maximum value of the signal is there. Okay, so minimum value and maximum value. So here we have another one, linear ramp generator. So in the previous case we have a voltage divider. Okay, so here we are using a linear ramp generator. So linear ramp generator. So this step converter will compare. This is comparator. This is the start comparator, and this is the stop comparator. The start comparator will compare the 0% voltage memory signal with the linear ramp generator. Suppose the linear signal is generating, the linear signal is our sweep signal is generating, our ramp voltage is generating. Okay, so here it will be compares with the 0% voltage. Okay, and that voltage will be compares when these two are equal. It will produce a pulse signal. So that will make open the gate. So and here we have a 1 megahertz clock, and this clock will produce the clock signals. Okay, and those clock signals will be processed through this clock gate, and those clock pulses will be counted by the counter. So whereas in the previous case, these pulses our samples are generated from the sample signal. So here we are using a 1 megahertz clock, and this clock will generate the clock pulses, and these clock pulses will be processed through the clock gate when the start compact will produce the start gate or open gate or start pulse. Okay, so until it will be sends the clock pulses up to the stop compact will produce the stop signal or closing gate signal. That closing gate signal will be produced when this compact will compare with the 100% voltage signal with the ramp voltage. So when these two signals are equal, it produces the stop signal, and then this clock gate will be closes. And within that opening and closing of this clock gate, it will produce these clock pulses. And those clock pulses will be counted by the digital readout or digital counter. So here, this value will be, the obtained value is proportional to how much voltage. So how much clock pulses are generated for a given period of time. For a given period of time, how many pulses are counted. Okay, so here this count will be proportional to the time. This counter value, so our display value is proportional to the, so the how many pulses are generated in a given period of time. That given period of time is decided by this 0% voltage and 100% voltage. So we can set the time period. So for the given period of time, how much we have to measure the we can measure the clock pulses. How many clock pulses will be passed through clock gate when the voltage or the given period of time. So that given period of time is nothing but here in this case, this is the voltage. Okay. And this voltage is having a minimum value and maximum value. And minimum value will be considered 0% voltage. So here we can observe this one. So this is a ramp signal. And this is the minimum value of the voltage. So if you consider this the ramp signal, okay, and this is the minimum value of the voltage, and this is the maximum value of the voltage, or that will be considered as the 100%. This is the 100%, and this is the 0%. So this is the 0% voltage. So within this period of time, period, so it will produce the pulses, and that pulses will be considered as the and those pulses will be counted, clock pulses will be counted, and it will give directly relationship with the given period of time how many clocks are generated. So like this we can measure the voltage to time conversion. With that we can measure the how many clock pulses are generated. In this case, the CRT is obtained by sampling 0% reference voltage as chosen by the memory circuit. So the linear ramp generator produces the voltage when the ramp voltage equals to 0% reference of the gate opens. So when the ramp voltage equals the 0% reference, the gate opens. So here we have two comparators, start comparator and stop comparator. When linear ramp voltage will produce the ramp signal, that will be sent to start comparator, and also 0% voltage memory will produce the voltage. That voltage, when these two are equal, that is first point. So here, so at that moment, the start comparator will be produces the signal. So by that pulse signal, the clock gate will be opens, and the 1 megahertz clock pulse pulses will pass through this clock signal and it will be counted by counter. So next, the 100 voltage will be generated. 100% voltage means, so this is the maximum position of the for our sample time. Okay, so at this point of voltage, that voltage is sensed to stop comparator, and also the same linear ramp voltage is sensed to stop comparator. So here these two will be compared. It produces the stop signal, and these two signals will be sensed to the stop signal will be sensed to clock gate. Okay, and the clock gate will be closes, and at that moment there is no clock pulses. There is no clock pulses pass through this clock gate. Okay, and in between time of this for 0% and 100% of the voltage, so how many pulses are allowed to pass through the clock gate will be counted by the counter. So like this we can produce the counter. So the number of clock pulses that activate the counter is directly proportional to the voltage between the selected reference and is read out in millivolts or volts by the Nixie tube display. So here the number of clock pulses that activate the counter is directly proportional to the voltage between the selected reference and is read out in millivolts. So here by opening and closing of the gates, so we have producing some clock pulses, and those clock pulses will be directly proportional, the number of clock pulses is directly proportional to the voltage between the between this period, given period. So it produces the given period of given value of the voltage between two reference points. So it is in terms of readout in millivolts or volts by using the Nixie tube. So what I was saying in previous one, so these are the Nixie tube display. So it will display the values as in our 7-segment display. Okay. So this so we have discussed about so dual beam CRO, dual trace CRO, sampling oscilloscope, storage oscilloscope, and digital readout oscilloscope. So these five are important, very very important. You can expect any question out of this. Out of these five, we can expect anyone, or maybe expect two also. So next one is frequency measurement by Lissow Just method. So in the first class, we are told that by using the oscilloscope, we can measure the voltage value, current value, and its frequency also. So frequency of the given signal and also time period. So by using the time period, we can measure the frequency. Okay. So here we have a method, so which is based upon the Lissow Just method. So Lissow Just method, we can measure the frequency of the given signal. So to measure this frequency of the unknown signal frequency, we have to apply the known signal frequency. Okay, for a horizontal deflection system, we will apply the known signal frequency, known frequency signal, and for the vertical system or the vertical deflection system, we will apply the unknown frequency signal. Okay, so to know the unknown signal frequency, so we have to apply these two signals to the one is applied for the vertical amplifier section and another is for the horizontal deflection system. So in this case, we will not use the any sweep generator. We do not use the sweep generator. Okay, so it means the input signal does not connect to the vertical the horizontal deflection system. After the amplification vertical amplifier section, the signal does not connect to the trigger section of the Hodgson deflection system. Okay, so we can disconnect that and we will connect to the external terminal. So here we have three terminals. So one is a line terminal, external terminal, and internal terminal. So that is synchronous selection. So synchronous selection, we have line selection, external, and internal. So internal connection is connected from the vertical amplifier. Line connection is connected from the transformer. So external transformer signal for measuring of the AC. So we have another terminal, that is the external terminal. So that from that external terminal, we will apply the signal, known frequency signal. So this is the diagram. By this way, we can apply the signal. So unknown frequency signal is applied for the vertical amplifier section, and the known frequency signal is applied for the horizontal deflection system. So by applying these two signals, frequency signals, so we will get the display as a pattern. So and those patterns will be called as Lissajous patterns. Okay, these are not like our sine wave signal. Okay, so they will produce as some circular type of the display, and these patterns are called as Lissajous patterns. See here, these are the some examples of the Lissajous patterns. So here, circular or ellipse type of the representation will be obtained on the CRT screen. Okay, so depending upon the frequencies, depending upon the frequency of the horizontal and the vertical deflection systems. Okay. So the in detailed version of this, how we can measure by using Lissajous pattern, we will see in the next class. So with this, we have any doubts or clarifications, we can put chart. Put in your chart. If you don't have any doubts, I will close this session.